You know, today's chapter, Matthew 2 and even verse 1 to 11, and we can see how human nature possibly turns quickly from good to evil. On one side, we have a good nature. We are caring, loving, and generous. I'm sure you are a good parent, friend, an excellent employee or employer. But on the other side, we have a sinful nature. We are jealous, selfish, angry, hateful, and double-minded. There is a very thin line between these two natures. Sometimes we are a good person, sometimes we turn into the other nature comes out. And we are struggling between these two. When you are jealous, you probably know you are jealous. When you are angry, you probably know you have anger. But there is a one sinful nature which we are dealing with every day in our lives, but we don't even know we have. It is called controlling personality. You know, controlling personality. In my opinion, personal opinion, this controlling personality is the worst sinful nature because it is invisible. It's hard to be detected because this personality often disguises itself as a good or a strong leadership or a caring personality. It's always there. But we don't know if we have it or not. We think that this person is a good person, this person has a good leadership, but actually the person has a controlling personality. It slowly and unnoticeably destroys our soul, spirit, and relationship with others, as well as our relationship with the Lord. Now, someone called controlling personality as boiling frog. I'm sure you know a frog. Like how a frog doesn't know if the water, you know, is getting hot, it doesn't jump out, and eventually the frog dies. So controlling personality gradually kills you, and you would never know. For example, if you are dating with a man, he buys you flowers every day, calls you every 30 minutes, or texts you every minute, says, I love you, honey. It sounds like you found your dream relationship. But there is a good chance that he is not being entirely honest with you. He might be laying a groundwork to control you later. So you got to be careful if you are dating with this type of person. If you know a person who is a very emotional, either sad or excited, the person might try to control the circumstance he is in so he can get all the attention. If you know a person who often excessively turns a little thing into a major big deal, the person might have a controlling personality too. You know, we call that kind of person as drama queen. Whenever the person goes, whoever the person meets, there will be always a trouble. You know, we all suffer from this controlling personality to some degree, whether or not you recognize. You know, I saw a bumper sticker last year. It says, I'm not bossy, I just know what you ought to do. You know, we don't know we have this issue. We think that we are a good leader or a caring person, but we are actually a boiling frog. We messed up our lives, we also messed up others' lives. eventually we isolated ourselves from other people. I'm pretty sure you know this type of person and you don't want to hang out with this type of person. I know a person who has this controlling issue and his marriage is shaking. He has to move his job a few times because he doesn't get along with other people. When his idea doesn't get through, he usually turns angry. When Jesus was on the road to Jerusalem, over 1 million people came out and shouted for the Lord. They were urban peasants who heard about the Lord. They were so excited to see that their Savior finally was coming for them. The street was packed with people, over 1 million people. You know, Jerusalem is not a big city. It's as big as a lion's. So think about it. Over 1 million people is packed with a lion's. They came out waving palm branches, shouting Hosanna. They put their clothes on the dirt. It was a king's parade. It's very exciting. It looks great, you know, awesome. Our king is coming. But actually, it is a false coronation. It is a strange coronation. Because their excitement for the king is not real for the king. Their shouting Hosanna for the Savior is not real for the Savior. It's coming from their controlling desire. They already set their mindset on what the king has to do for them. They don't think about what the Lord is going to do for their salvation. It's all about them. It's all about their desire. But the real interesting part is, the strange part is, there really is no question about Christ. They have all the correct information about the Lord. You know, Jesus is the Messiah. They know he's the promised king. They know he's the one with the right to reign. His lineage checks out. His mother and father, both in the line of David. He has all the qualifications. He's the Son of Man. He's the Son of God. He has demonstrated his deity and his full humanity throughout his ministry. He is the true king. What they say sounds awesome, sounds true confession, sounds true believers, sounds true follower of Christ. People have all the correct information, but this is a false coronation. That's why it's such a bizarre event. When you look at this passage, it's bizarre. It's not a true expression of faith. It's not a true expression of praise. It's not a true expression of acclaim. It certainly isn't God's coronation any more than it is a true human coronation. You know, if this is God's true coronation, it's not to be reversed in a few days. That Jesus who is exalted and Jesus who is exalted becomes rejected and executed by the same people. This is no real coronation. Let's be said, Jesus is the real king, deserving of all exaltation, all honor, all worship, and all praise. But this is false coronation of the true king. It's strange. It's bizarre. You know, false coronations like this go on every day in our lives. All the time. Just turn on your TV to some, you know, charismatic TV station. Watch all the, you know, hoopla about Jesus. And watch all the swaying, you know, groaning, moaning, singing and praising and listen to the people say, Jesus will make you rich. You know, Jesus will heal you. Jesus will give you all your dream come true in Jesus Christ. Jesus will fulfill all your desires. And I will tell you, all the praises and hoopla will go on until Jesus doesn't deliver the good, then the fallen sinner ones, they will turn on him. You know, that's very deadly things to do and very dishonoring to the Lord. That's why the prosperity message, we have to be careful, is so dangerous. It lies. It promises the sinner what the fallen sinner already wants in his corrupt condition. You know what a true believer? I'm pretty sure you are a true believer, true follower of Christ. What we really want is what will glorify God, honor him, increase his attractiveness to the people around him. So the crowd welcoming Jesus is controlled by what they try to control the Lord. They didn't really exalt him. They didn't really praise him. They thought that they praised him. It's not. They didn't. They control. They control the Lord. They seem to be very faithful, dedicated, and religious until Jesus attacks the simple belief. They don't know what they are doing. Over a million people are caught by their own ignorance, their own false idea on the Lord. That's what people who have controlling issue. If they don't get their idea passed through, they turn angry. That's why a million people turn their back against Christ. They don't know what they're doing. Now, there is an animal called a lemming. I'm sure you have heard about this animal. This animal looks like a squirrel or a rat. And it is a very interesting one, actually. It has another name called a suicidal animal, or some people call them the marching moron. And once in a while, a group of lemmings, I mean hundreds of lemmings, run to the cliff and jump up mindlessly and kill themselves. So for a long time, scientists study about their behavior, and they found out one lemming begins to run, and then other lemmings join the lemming. Then while they are running, all other group of lemmings join them without knowing where they are going. What they doing? They just keep running and running and running. I run because you run. You run because I run. So hundreds of lemmings just keep running. Then finally they jump off the cliff. Why they jump off the cliff? Because this lemming jumped up, so I jumped up, but you jumped up, so hundreds of lemmings killed themselves. The marching moron. It's like the boiling frog. They keep doing something, but they don't know it's going to kill them later. This is what the crowd does in Jesus' time. They just follow what others do, you know, going out, waving palm branches, shouting, putting their clothes on the dirt. Why did they do that? Because my friends did it, my parents did it, my brother did it, but they don't know what they are doing. They just do. Then later, the same hands waving the palm branches point to Jesus, and the same mouth shouting Hosanna yell, heal him. Same hands, same mouth, but different reaction, because they didn't know what they were doing. What a sad crowd. Men and women, young and old, they are marching moron. They are the boiling frog. That's why Jesus on the cross said, "Father, please forgive them. They don't know what they are doing." Yeah, that's why it is God's blessing for you and I in the right church, where the true followers of Christ gather, worship, believe the true King. We believe the true King. We are not here worship God because other people worship God. We are not here worshiping the Lord because our parents worshiping the Lord. We are here because we truly believe Jesus Christ is our Savior. He's the true King. You have to believe that. You have to come to church because of your own personal confession, your own personal belief that Christ is our Savior. You know, the crowds have knowledge on Christ, but their knowledge is shallow and superficial. So their knowledge is nothing different from those who are non-believers in Jerusalem. They are Pharisees and Sadducees, leader of Israel. They are the elite. They are the smartest people in Jerusalem. But they ask, "Who is this man?" I mean, haven't they heard about the Lord last 3 years? And millions of people following the Lord and talk about Him? But these people who are smartest people, they are the religious leader, asking, "Who is this man?" Then the crowd answer, "This is the prophet Jesus." You know what the crowd said reminds me of what Jesus said. Matthew 15. "If a blind man leads another blind man, both will fall into a pit." Both crowd and the elite group, the religious leaders, fall into a pit. They are blind. You know, our Lord never called Himself a prophet. He called Himself friend, good shepherd, bread of life, light of the world, and Son of God. He never called Himself prophet. You know, we think we know Jesus, but we don't know because we don't have a personal relationship with Him and get to know Him deeply. In the scripture, Jesus never gathered huge crowd on the purpose to teach them. Jesus never did that. Jesus never called people, come to me, a lot of people. Jesus never did that. People just followed wherever He went. You know, I think this is a true model of church growth. We don't need to have a barbecue party every Sunday to attract people. We don't need a fancy church building or a state-of-the-art media equipment to attract people. When you have a good teaching, worship, and fellowship, people would hear about us and they come. Then they can join us. That's true model of church growth. Now, Jesus' favorite lesson plan is visiting each individual. We really have to understand this. His favorite lesson plan is visiting each individual. Throughout the scripture, He never turned the huge crowd His follower of God. He always visited each individual privately, separately, then turned the person into follower of Christ. That's His tactic, to change us, each individual, because He wants to have a deeper conversation with the person. He customizes His lesson to each different person so we can truly understand who Jesus really is and why He comes to us. We shouldn't be followers of a crowd. We shouldn't follow all the hoopla about Jesus, especially when it comes to your belief on the Lord. If you do, when Jesus comes to you, you might end up saying, who is this man? Who is this guy? You need to build a personal relationship with Christ. You alone need to have a deep relationship with Him. You know, we all like to eat Krispy Kreme donut. The founder of Krispy Kreme donut was a very faithful follower of Christ. As you know, Krispy Kreme donut, they never advertise. They never spend any money, even a dime, to advertise their company. The guy who found the Krispy Kreme donut figured it out. Jesus approached to each individual person. Jesus never advertised himself. That's why he got this idea that when I build my company, I'm not going to advertise my company. It's all about taste and quality. That's why Krispy Kreme donut never advertised even today. But people love to eat Krispy Kreme donut. I love to eat Krispy Kreme donut. If I live right next to Krispy Kreme donut and next to Starbucks company, I feel so happy. It's all about the taste and the quality. That's what Jesus wants us to be. True follower of Christ. He wants us to have a deeper relationship with Him. That's what He did 2,000 years ago. That's what He does even today. He comes to you, wants to change you. He's customized His lesson plan to you in your own circumstance. So don't be a follower of a crowd. If you do, when Christ comes to you, when He comes and wants to talk to you, then you say, who are you? Who are you? Who is this person? You alone need to have a deep relationship with Him. I'm pretty convinced that if all over a million people have personal relationship with Jesus Christ, they wouldn't kill their Lord. They have a wrong information about Him. They have a wrong belief about Jesus Christ because they follow what other people did. That's wrong. You need to go deeper. You alone yourself every single day. That's why we need to pray every day, read the scripture every day. If I want to know you, I want to spend more time with you personally. And once a week here, worship time, it's not enough for me to know you, for me to know me. Our relationship will be superficial, shallow. You know, Jesus Christ is not a prophet. He's not a prophet. He's not just a man. He's our Lord. He's Christ. He's our Savior. He's the only Savior who can save us. There is no other name who can save us. Only Jesus Christ, His blood, His cross can save us. If you don't know about this, even if you have all the correct information about the Lord, Son of God, the Son of David, Messiah, whatever you know about Him, that's wrong. He cannot save you. He cannot save your soul. Only thing you need to know about the Lord is He is the Savior, comes to you individually. Your father must be a good Christian. Your father must be a pastor. Your father's parents must be elders and deacons. But their faith has nothing to do with you. This is my prayer for my children every single day. I talk to my children, pray every day. Only one thing I keep asking every day, Jaden Logan, do you believe Jesus Christ is your Savior? I believe in God. Susan believes in Jesus Christ, but my faith, Susan's faith, have nothing to do with my children's faith. They are not be saved automatically. It's their faith. If they don't confess that Jesus Christ is their Savior, where are they going when they leave this world? Only two places, hell or heaven. Think about it, where you end up staying when you leave this world. Christ is our Lord, our Savior. That's the only reason He came to us 2,000 years ago, even today. I hope that all of us, First Presbyterian Church, Christian, follower of Christ, we are all true followers of Christ, true believers, believing Christ is our Savior, only Savior. There is no other name in the world who can save us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, knowing You as our Savior doesn't come from a shallow knowledge that everyone knows. Satan even knows who You are. Our true faith in You comes from the belief that You are our Savior. You are only Savior. Without Your name, there's no one on earth who saves us from our eternal damnation. Thanks for this truth, Lord. Thanks for letting us know this truth. Thank You so much. We are blessed by this truth. Now we are saved. We know we are saved. In Your name we pray. Amen.